Life has always been a metaphor for knowledge. And throughout history, there have been a number of ways of shedding light on things. It has only been about 200 years now that light has been shed on and by electric currents. In this episode of A World in Motion, we'll examine electric circuits and the energy conversions that occur in them. We'll investigate electrical energy conversions in the laboratory and in other applications. We'll trace the discovery of sustained electric currents and sources of voltage. By the end of this program, you should be able to define current, resistance, and voltage, as well as calculate the quantity of energy being converted in an electric circuit. The most pressing concern is, how can 36 cents light a light bulb?
I think that's everything you'll need.
For what?
To light a light.
You're joking, right? A bunch of coins, some tissue paper, and salt?
Well, no. There's water. And wires, too.
Okay, I'll bite. How about a hint?
Oh, absolutely.
The water in this waterfall is in motion because it's in the gravitational field of Earth. It experiences a force due to gravity. Any mass in a gravitational field has gravitational potential energy. The change in gravitational potential energy per unit mass from the initial position to the final position is called the gravitational potential difference. Similarly, a charged object in an electric field has electric potential energy. If the object moves, its electric potential changes as well. The change in electric energy per unit charge from the initial position to the final position is called the potential difference, or voltage.
You call that a hint?
Or you could call it an analogy.
Well, I see the connection. In a circuit, we have a source of potential difference.
The power supply?
Yeah, it's a source of potential difference, just like gravitational potential difference.
Similar, because both terms refer to a difference in potential energy.
Yeah.
Well, and difference implies a change in energy, hence the light.
Right.
Right. How does the energy get over there?
Inside a dry cell, a chemical reaction causes a buildup of opposite charges at the poles of the cell. This process stops very quickly, though, unless the cell is connected to a circuit. Connecting the cell to a conductor, like this wire, induces an electric field in the conductor. Any charge in the wire will experience a force due to this field. Materials that are conductors have some loosely held electrons, which move as a result of this force.
So the electrons in the conductor are like the water in the waterfall?
Yeah, they have a certain amount of electric potential. And as they move through the...
A closed conducting path, a circuit.
As they move through the circuit, they provide some energy to other things in the circuit.
Creating the light.
Right, Juliana. So the electrons are like the water in the waterfall.
And the rivers above it and below it are like the conductors.
And the waterfall is the place where the potential energy gets changed to some other form.
Electrons are too numerous to keep track of individually. It is much simpler to represent a coulomb of charge. Each electron has a charge of 1.60 times 10 to the negative 19 coulombs. So the inverse of that value, or 6.25 times 10 to the 18 electrons, gives a total charge of 1 coulomb. When a coulomb of charge leaves a cell, it has a certain electric potential. In the conductors, the electric potential remains almost unchanged. But a load in the circuit, such as a light bulb, will convert that electric potential to another form of energy. Electrons returning to the cell, therefore, have less electric potential than those leaving. The chemical process inside the cell converts chemical energy to electric energy, so the process can continue.
We're going to check out the potential differences around the circuit.
I've checked all the connections. There's no loose wires. We're ready to go.
Good. But before you begin, let me ask, where do you expect to find a potential difference in your circuit?
Across the bulb and across the power supply.
Why not in the conducting wires?
Because there's no potential difference there.
Because all of the energy conversions happen in the bulb and in the power supply.
Okay, let's see.
In the power supply, the electrons gain electric potential. And in the filament of the bulb, the electrons lose electric potential as electric energy is converted to light and heat.
Your connections are correct and solid, so go ahead and take your measurements.
Okay. The potential across the conductor from the negative end of the power supply to the bulb is 0.003 volts.
That's 3 millivolts.
Across the bulb, it's 3.04 volts. Across the second conductor, it's 3 millivolts. And across the power supply, it's 3.08 volts.
Good work with the voltmeter. Are you surprised the conductors didn't have a potential difference of zero?
Yeah, what's going on?
Well, their resistance is very low, but it's not zero, so it takes some work for the electrons to move through the wires.
But most of the potential difference is in the power supply and the bulb?
And it's almost the same in both.
Does it have to be the same amount?
If the law of conservation of energy is to hold, then it must be the same.
But how does the energy get converted in the bulb?
This water wheel is designed to harness the gravitational potential energy of water to do work. The water wheel resists the flow of the water. It slows down its fall. The water is not moving as fast as it would be if all the gravitational potential energy were converted to kinetic energy. Some energy has been converted to other forms or used to do work on the water wheel. The water wheel could be called a resistor. It resists the flow.
So then, our light bulb is a resistor.
But how's that different than the conducting wires?
Well, the atoms in some materials don't hold the electrons very tightly, so the electrons can flow rather easily.
That's a conductor.
Right, but if the electron flow is hindered by the material,
then the material acts as a resistor.
And converts electric energy to some other form of energy.
That's right.
In the simplest form, you can think of the LRT like a light bulb in a circuit. The light bulb in a circuit is a resistor, and the LRT in its circuit is a resistor. They're both energy converters, so the light bulb is converted potential electric energy into light and heat, and in the case of the LRT car, it's converted electrical potential energy into kinetic energy, which is motion. At this point here is where most of the energy conversion takes place in the LRT car. This is the power truck, and this is where the motor is located. It's a DC 600 volt motor, takes its power from the overhead catenary. Current flows through a bank of resistors into the motor, and when the current flows through the coils in the motor, it converts the electrical energy into a kinetic energy, which turns the armature. Once the train is running, we take that kinetic energy in the braking process and we convert that back to electrical energy and dissipate that through some resistors, which produces heat. And that, in the reverse, slows the armature down in the motor and slows the train down. And the heat from those resistors we use to heat the car in the winter.
Hi, I've got the circuit almost finished.
So I see. What's left?
Well, I have the conductors connected to the light bulb, which is the resistor.
So now we need to supply a potential difference, a voltage source.
Yes, a voltage source is essential to creating an electric current. A flow of electric charge is known as electric current. The rate of charge flow is measured in terms of the amount of charge passing a point in the circuit per unit of time. The symbol for current is capital I, and it is measured in coulombs per second, or amperes. This ammeter measures current flow. So it's connected into the circuit so that the current must flow through it. It's called a series connection. Let's see how much current is flowing through your circuit.
Okay, that's 66 milliamperes or 66 milliamps.
Good. Current is charge divided by time. So if we allow the circuit to run for 1.0 minutes, how many coulombs of charge would flow through this bulb?
Current is charge divided by time, so rearranging...
Charge equals current times time.
Time is 1 minute.
Well, the current is in amps, which is coulombs per second, so we'd better convert 1 minute into 60 seconds to get the units to cancel.
Right.
So, 66 millicoulombs per second times 60 seconds.
Okay.
That gives us 3,960 millicoulombs or 4.0 coulombs of charge.
Good work.
Yeah.
Now, can we determine the change in energy if we know the charge and the voltage?
Sure. Just use the equation, change in energy equals the charge times the voltage.
Yes. So let's continue from where we left off. 4.0 coulombs of charge flow through the circuit.
And the potential difference our power supply provides is 3.08 volts. So the change in energy is 12 coulomb volts.
Good work. But see if you can't simplify those units.
Well, a volt is a joule per coulomb, so the coulombs cancel, leaving only joules.
Good, because that's the correct unit for energy.
Right.
The change in energy of the water in this waterfall is due to a change in position. But no water is lost in the process. Every drop of water could be accounted for, at least in theory. The same holds true for charges flowing through a circuit. As charge flows around a circuit, it transfers energy to loads in the circuit, but the charges are not consumed. As many coulombs of charge leave the light bulb here as flowed into it here. The law of conservation of charge summarizes this principle. The net charge of an isolated system remains constant.
Well, we know the current used by an old trolley car, so we could figure out the energy being converted.
Okay, all right.
The current used is 320 amps.
We need to decide on a time.
Let's use 1.0 minutes again.
Okay, that's 60 seconds.
Okay, so our original equation was current equals charge divided by time.
Multiply time on both sides of the equation to get charge equals current times time.
Substituting in a current of 320 coulombs per second.
And the time is 60 seconds. Giving us 19,200 coulombs.
So we'll call that 1.92 times 10 to the 4 coulombs of charge.
Good. We don't round too far until we get to the final answer, and we still have one step left.
The unit of potential difference, the volt, is named after Alessandro Volta. Volta created a crude electrochemical cell called a voltaic pile. This device prompted great leaps in electrical and other sciences. Within months of Volta's report, William Nicholson and Anthony Carlyle discovered that water was not an element. They used electric current to decompose water into hydrogen and oxygen for the first time in history. Thank you.
To find the energy, you need to know the voltage the trains operate on is about 600 volts.
Well, the change in energy is equal to the charge times the voltage.
Substituting gives us 1.92 times 10 to the 4 coulombs times 600 volts.
That gives 1.15 times 10 to the 7th joules of energy.
Rounded, giving us 1.2 times 10 to the 7th joules.
Good work. Now, if we assume that electric energy is completely converted to kinetic energy, at what speed would a 10-ton trolley car be traveling?
Well, the energy change we just calculated would become kinetic energy of the trolley, which is equal to 1 half mv squared.
Multiplying both sides by 2 and dividing by m, we get 2ek over m equals v squared.
So the speed is equal to the square root of 2ek over m.
Substituting, we get the square root of 2 times 1.2 times 10 to the 7 joules divided by
1.0 times 10 to the 4th kilograms.
And that's 10 tons.
Rounding gives us 49 meters per second.
Not likely.
You're right. That's about 175 kilometers per hour. A bit fast for a streetcar from 1920. Desire or no?
Our calculations were correct.
It was our assumptions. Not all of the electric energy would be converted to kinetic energy.
Who knows? Maybe the motors wouldn't always get the same current.
Good points. Efficiency is never 100%. And the so-called motor man on the trolley adjusts the current to the motors to control the speed.
At the time of Volta, and for many years after, it was commonly held that the charge that was flowing through circuits was positive. By the end of the 19th century, it was discovered that negatively charged particles, electrons, were mobile, and the positive charge was stationary. Many resources still refer to conventional current, which is positive charge flow. It's important to note that in this series, when we discuss current, we will consider electron flow.
If we know that electrons are flowing, why do people continue to use conventional current?
Well, in part because it's used so commonly in the world, not just in science, but in industry, and in part because it corresponds to our ideas in electric fields.
What does it have to do with electric fields?
Do you remember how we defined the direction of an electric field?
That's the direction a positive charge would travel in the field. So I guess it makes some sense to use positive charges with electric circuits.
I suppose.
Standard symbols are used to communicate the components of an electric circuit. A single cell is represented as two parallel lines, the positive terminal being longer than the negative. In this flashlight, there are two cells in series. Our circuit diagram shows both of them. Metal conductors connect the cells to the light bulb. Conductors are represented in circuit diagrams as lines. Finally, the load here is a light bulb. The symbol for a bulb is this. In general, any load or resistor is shown as a jagged line.
I see you have diagrammed your circuit. Conducting wire is connected to a resistor, which is
the bulb.
And we figured out how to build the voltage source.
Thanks to Mr. Volta for the idea.
I can't wait. Let's see what you can do.
Ready to make the final connection?
Here goes nothing.
You were right. Nothing.
Well, one thing's for sure. It isn't the brightest bulb on the porch.
What did you expect for 36 cents?
Well, if what we've done is correct, then there just isn't enough electric energy being converted to light the bulb.
I probably should have given you this.
What is it?
It's a light-emitting diode, an LED. Try it in place of your bulb.
Well, that looks like it might need a little less energy.
Okay, it's ready to go.
And?
Ta-da!
Well, there's some light there.
That's great. Although this pile of coins isn't as effective as a dry cell, the principles behind the two are the same.
What is a hybrid electric vehicle?
Well, as the name suggests, a hybrid electric vehicle
is one that uses two power sources. In this case, your conventional gasoline-powered engine, as well as electricity stored in batteries.
So why even have one?
Well, if you want to build a pure electric car, you would have to carry really heavy batteries, and it's not really practical. Mm-hmm. So what we do is that we use a small amount of batteries that will get you your daily driving, and then we use a small gasoline engine to use on long distance driving.
Well, let's see the engine. There we go.
So here we have two electric motors and the motor controllers and our small three-cylinder gasoline engine. And with electric power, people can drive to and from work just using electric power, and they don't produce any emissions. So it cuts down a lot on urban air pollution.
So where are the batteries located?
Well, the batteries take up a lot of space, so we have them located in underneath the rear seat. We take the seat out so you can get a better look at them. You can see they're quite large, and they weigh about 600 pounds.
And how far do they go on one charge?
You go about 50 to 70 kilometers. It really depends on how you drive, just like your fuel economy in your regular car changes. Mm-hmm. The main problem with today's electric vehicles is the batteries simply do not store enough energy. So companies are doing research around the world on increasing the energy density so you can store more energy for a given weight or volume of battery. One example is Ford's sodium sulfur battery, where they're aiming for storing 3 times more energy than our nickel cadmium batteries. So that would give a vehicle a range of 200 to 300 kilometers on a single charge.
When will we be able to see more electric vehicles on the road?
Well, you won't see them in Alberta for quite a number of years yet. Our air is relatively clean, and our winters require a lot of energy just to heat the car. Where you'll see them first is likely in California, where they have heavy pollution in their large cities, and that's where the government has put in laws mandating electric vehicles starting in 1998.
Before, we saw that the voltage changes across the cell and the load.
Well, let's start at the cell.
It's a whopping 4.75 volts.
And what about across the LED?
It's 1.75 volts, the same magnitude.
Well, let's determine the current then.
I'll hook that up.
But it's not very much.
You're right. It's 0.30 milliamps.
That is extremely small, but you know, even a very small amount of current can still be dangerous.
How so?
The cells of your body respond to an electric current. Just a few milliamperes of current can be painful.
Pain like when you get a shock from the carpet?
Yes, and about 1/10 of an amp can cause a heart fibrillation.
And that means?
Your heart beats regularly or very fast. As a result, your blood doesn't flow properly, if at all.
Tell me about the bionic glove.
Well, I'm a physiotherapist, and in physiotherapy, we use electrical stimulation in a number of applications, and this is a very specific application, using electrical stimulation to paralyze muscles so that the muscles can be made to move. And it very grossly mimics the signal that the brain would normally send down to the muscles, but it can't get through because of an injury. So on the back of this glove here, we have a microprocessor controller that provides or produces electrical stimulation. It goes through the wires to metal mesh contacts inside of the glove. Now that contact, when the glove is put on, meets up with this metal stud, and the current actually flows through the electrodes through the skin and causes the muscles to contract.
Is it safe to apply electrical current to the skin?
Well, with this particular application, we are looking at a very localized area of application. So we're not applying electrodes across his heart or any of the important organs, which could actually be potentially dangerous. We're not looking at applying it over his throat, which is also could cause potential problems.
So what are the amounts of voltage and current?
Well, the pulses you can hear, the clicking, are pulses of about 30 volts. And that's between this electrode and this electrode, but that's like pressure in a tap that's closed. opening the tap is equivalent to making contact with the skin, and now those pulses of current are flowing through my skin. So about 30 milliamp pulses, 30 volts, that translates into a resistance of about 1 kilo ohm or 1,000 ohms.
So the people who are using this can bring their wrist back, but they don't have any finger movement and they don't have any thumb movement. So we'll turn the stimulation on, and you can see that as he brings his wrist back, the muscles stimulate to close his hand and then to open his hand. Right now, this is a research device, and we're doing clinical trials, but our hope is that in the next little while, this will move from a research setting into the real world.
You know the potential difference and the current produced by your voltaic pile. What energy is being transferred?
We begin by determining the charge flowing.
Current is charge divided by time, so charge is current times time.
Let's stick to 1 minute as the time interval.
So that is 0.300 milliamps times 60 seconds.
That gives 18 millicoulombs.
And change in energy is charge times the voltage.
So that's 18 millicoulombs times 1.75 volts.
No wonder the light bulb wouldn't light.
Yeah, it's only 32 millijoules.
Only a fraction of the energy that was converted in the bulb earlier.
Right.
Well, I think we developed two very big ideas today.
Energy is conserved. The energy stored in a cell is only converted to other forms of energy.
And
charge is conserved. The cell doesn't make any electrons, and the load doesn't destroy any.
Good show. I hope it was clear just how dangerous electric current can be.
Oh yeah, extremely small currents can be painful.
And there's enough current running through a light bulb to kill.
That's right, because if you become part of the circuit, you act like a resistor.
Which means the energy is transferred to me.
That's the danger.
Charge in motion, or electric current, has been controlled and used for almost 200 years. In that time, it has been used to learn a great deal about the world. And it has shed other sorts of light as well. Thanks for joining us for A World in Motion.